Awesome. It's because we're both Eric's. Brandon and I were just talking, and we want to make a quick observation. This is nothing but an observation that we just made as we were walking around because it's something we thought was a little curious, constructive, and actually quite useful. Notice what many of you have done with your sheets of you. You basically have a picture of you on the table right now. We noticed that many of you turned it over. Quite a few of you crumpled them up. A lot of you have strategically placed things on top of this. And that's exciting for us, because I think that means you took it seriously when you were doing it, because there's no other reason to hide it unless it's true.
I just wanted to see what was on the other side.
Which is also good. That's also a plus. Can we talk the first thing we have is, what identities do your students bring to class? If you were to imagine your students filling out that exact same form that you just did a few moments ago, what kinds of things do you think would be in those spaces? Would anyone like to share their impressions? You shut up. Oh, right. Now, how would you phrase that as an identity issue?
I read well, or I don't read well. That's fantastic.
What else?
Things that people didn't say on the outside, but everybody knows about them. Like, I have curly hair, I wear glasses, sure. Things that are, like, visible, but people know anyway, so it's safer.
Nice.
Yeah, I also think you need to write some really personal stuff down, just the way that they know their teams, and like, I feel really comfortable with everybody at my table, and so I didn't mind being honest. Whereas, you know, it's a community here where they don't have that same connection with their teams. I mean, we wish they do, but you know, they're always going to be.
Well, there's not the maturity.
Yeah.
Other sort of identity bubbles that you would diagnose for your students. We've got the sort of physical attributes. I'm tall, I'm short. We've got academic attributes. I've typically been told that I'm smart or that I'm not, or that I'm a hard worker or that I'm not. Those might be some of the identity bubbles that we have circulating around some of your students. What?
I work in special ed, so like, I
next question that we have up here is a little bit more esoteric and weird than it seems, and I think it's something we might actually bring back next week, but something that you think is compelling. And that's that, how do the different spaces make possible different identity bubbles being valued or not valued? When we think, for example, about our friends in special ed, there is probably a chance that those identity bubbles function differently in the classroom around a bunch of other kids who are similarly categorized. Perhaps you have classes that have a sort of academic enrichment component where all the kids all sort of feel the same way as smart, but when they go in the hallway or when they go to the playground, those bubbles interact differently. Is that true? Can someone offer an example of how something that might, remember way back, like 35 minutes ago, when Brandon had us do these bubbles, and did these little bubbles, we put the same identity being positively valued and then negatively valued, and we talked about that in terms of time context. How about in terms of the context of the school that you're actually in? How the same attribute or identity bubble might be something you feel really good about, and you can let shine in the classroom, but you have to hide in the hallway or on the playground. Back
home. A lot of my very energetic boys, specifically the girls too, they love to show how flexible they are, how fast they are, how quickly they can move from one side of the room to the other while sliding on their shoes or their socks or something. And I have to say, don't do that in the classroom, it's not safe. Please put your shoes on, stop doing that, let's get in line, let's go back to class. But then, like, the second that they hit that outside door, it's, like, totally accessible, totally acceptable. Go ahead and do whatever you want as long as you don't break them. You know what I mean?
And then how is that identity a factor for how they interact with their peers on the playground? Differently as well, right?
Yeah, I think, those kids that are more energetic and less willing to sit down for long periods of time are, like, suddenly the fastest kids on the playground. You know, the coolest kids ever. whereas they were the disruptive one classrooms.
Well, and how about when our kids, like our smaller kids, for example, in our rooms, are in many different classrooms, but in the lunchroom or on the playground, if you look out, but they haven't got to do that in the classroom.
Fantastic. What do you think that means?
They want to, they feel safe there. They feel connected and safe. And I would do the same thing. In the lunchroom, we sit as fourth grade teams. We have things we're going to talk about. We have to see each other all being sort of talking about things that are common for us. We're there doing the same thing at work. You know, we're feeling, doing the common things, but it just is like, not that it's safe and sit by each other, that's great, but piece of that interaction, but it's in the lunchroom and outside of the playground, we see the same thing where they immediately turn it again, which we as adults do too.
I love that example, and so I'm going to play with it a little bit without judgment. If we say that they come together and they're allowed to have that identity bubble together and feel safe together on the playground, what does that say about how they feel in the classroom?
They not feel like everybody they can talk to or share with?
What are they hiding? Are they flipping over the page? What are they hiding? Because they can flip the page over with their peers on the playground, but they don't feel like they can do it in the classroom, in the hallway, in those spaces.
I was going to share about some of my small students. The other day, a group of my eighth grade boys were all gathered around, passing around a book. And class was starting, and I asked them to put it away. And after class, I asked the owner of the book what it was, and he goes, "Oh, it's the Quran. I've memorized the first so many verses," and he was so incredibly proud of that. And I'm sure, you know, as class started, was sharing that with his buddies. And it made me feel wonderful that he was excited to share that with me. But it also does make me wonder, so he was sharing it with his Somali classmates, people that understood the significance of that, and wondering where else he feels comfortable to do that.
At first, I've seen it both sides. So like, as Kayla said, you know, he wanted to share with the other smaller students. But when I was student teaching in the first grade during Christmas, you know, we educated them on different things about Christmas, and then, you know, I had students, three smaller students, that were super proud and wrote us a book about Islamic and what they celebrate and how they were, it might be just an age thing also, you know, more judgment, because this is first grade. So like more judgment comes from maybe older students, but they were super proud, and like the first graders are super accepting, they love, you know, hearing about it and what they do for different holidays.
What happens? Because primary seems to be more accepting of the belief. Mm-hmm.
That's something we're going to talk about later, Tammy, so don't worry about it.
Told that we should not judge. But she made a very clear point that that's not what we're taught. Because we can all be told all these wonderful things, but one of the messages that our students are learning, either subtly, intentionally, unintentionally from us, but also from society at large, their families, their places of worship, from the media. And so on the one hand, we tell them, don't bully. Talk if you bully. what they're taught, on the other hand, we may see some different behaviors. And that's where the challenge comes in helping bridge that gap to figure out what role do you all have as teachers here at Kennedy to help the students understand where they are at the appropriate developmental level and where we want them to get to and what that looks like when everyone is moving together. It's hard. That's why I'm 100% sure I can never do what you do. I can't be around little kids. That's not my place. It's not my folks. I use words that are really multisyllabic and big crazy thoughts. Kids are not my thing. And I'm appreciative of you all doing that. But I also understand that we have a great responsibility. I also know you understand that too. I want to go back to you.
Oh, that's great. And the flip side of what you're saying, I think, is fantastic. It needs to be said more often. And that's that, think of how often you have to suppress passion or rage, justifiably not. You know, this is a goofy story that I hesitate to tell, but Lori may have told something that I ran for office last time around. You may have seen that I got clobbered, but that's a different issue. When you do that, you knock on doors and talk to people you don't know. And I remember very clearly this one door that I knocked, and I was talking to this woman, and of course, especially after what happened at Crossroads, people often said that the biggest issue that they felt this community faced was, they would say diversity, or they would say education, or they would say those damn symbols. They would say one of those three things, and they meant the same thing every time they did. I remember speaking to this one woman who was in tears. She was probably early 70s, and she was in tears because she said she didn't want to feel like a racist. But she just felt uncomfortable, and she didn't know what to do, but she didn't want to be a racist. Isn't that fascinating? Mm-hmm. The other bits that we have to repress too, it's not all good stuff. Sometimes it's stuff that we're not super proud of, the identity bubbles that we kind of have there. Now this notion of repression, you guys are having a wonderful conversation, and this is fantastic. I love the way you guys are talking. But we do need to move a little bit into what you were already starting to talk about. We didn't ask you to start talking about populations with race, but you did. You see what I'm saying? We didn't ask you to start talking about your Somali population, but that's where you went pretty quickly. Of the things that you leave behind, they are not all equal. The things that you leave behind, when you look at the list behind, the LDIs that you put on your forms, the things that you left behind, they're not all equal. Think about, so that when you look at how those, that list of identity bubbles that you have are, it would hurt you more to hold some of them back than others, wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. And in fact, there are others that you can't hold back, no matter how much you want to. One of those, the most salient of those, that we want to talk about today a little bit, is race. That's what we're going to know is to talk, go down to talk about a little bit like that. Because when we think about that, as we remember, right? When you went to a job interview, you wore a shirt and pants because that's who you are. That's beautiful, fantastic, wonderful, but you still dressed up, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
We still change ourselves a little bit for job interviews for sake of power in different contexts. We all do that all the time. But there's a limit on the kinds of things that you can change sometimes, isn't there? So we want to talk about one of those identity bubbles that maybe some of your students can't repress. Does that make sense? And that maybe we don't repress as much as we think we do. And that's specifically race. Now I apologize that this is about to get really boring. The fun part is over. Friends, it's much more interesting than me. And now it's going to get a bit esoteric, but that's what we're supposed to do. But in order to make it less boring than it could be, so I'm going to put the cursor over somebody, and I want you to tell me who they are. Tell me what they are. Excuse me. Tell me what they are. All right. What are we doing with her? Come on now, speak up.
There you go.
All right. I'm hearing that a lot. There she goes. All right. This dude. All right. This lady. This one. I'm just putting the word if you say first and loudest. This one? Spanish. All right. This one. I heard Asian, so you win. We're running out of white people. We never heard that in Canada before. We're running out of white people. Is he up here? It's up here. I know they're hard to see, and I apologize for that. This guy? True, be accurate or inaccurate anyway. So the thing that we have here that is a really, I think, a fantastic point is that doing something like this out loud can often be very challenging. We have this incredible phobia when it comes to the word race quite often, don't we? Unless it's preceded by, I'm not a racist, but. In that case, you can say whatever you want. That's the only time we say that word race and we don't feel a little bit uncomfortable about it. And your point that this is it's arbitrary and it's weird, that's absolutely true, it actually is spot on. But realize that that's something that people do individually all the time. And in a sense, stereotyping is a very natural human thing to do. If you didn't stereotype that as a door, you would never be able to open it. Because it would be the first time you saw a door, every time you saw a door. And you'd be like, what the hell is this? Oh, I'm glad this reminds me of past door-like experiences. But the point that I'm trying to make is that while race seems like it's precise, our experience with it was that it's not. In reality, it's constructed. There's a space in the middle. And so in order to get some insight into that, I'm going to bore you with a little bit of history really quickly. And why do we talk about history when it comes to race? My argument why we do it this way is because it hasn't always been the way we think it is now. And that's how we get insight into what can become, is if we're critical about what used to be. When we realize that race hasn't always meant the same thing that we think it does, it doesn't have to mean what it does now. Does that make sense? Like, for example, how many of you were on planes in the 70s? Was anyone on an airplane, like, in 1979? Not that specific year. Thanks for being there for me, Dave. You've been on an airplane. I was there, too. Do you remember getting on a plane or buying a ticket and having the person ask if you wanted to be smoking or not smoking? Mm-hmm. What? Can you get on the plane? Do you guys see the conceptual problem there? You're in a tube! You're only in a tube! And the thing that separates the smoking section from the non-smoking section is what? Air! You're in a tube! That doesn't work! Now, if you said something like this in 1978 and said, you know, conceptually, I'm not quite sure I follow the smoking versus non-smoking arrangement, people would think you're crazy, but that we were in the moment and it made perfectly good sense. It doesn't. It's insane. Much like the history of race. So let's play with it a little bit, shall we? Who is this lady? That's a weird one, right? Who is this lady? Anybody? Oh, I like that.
From a card game.
It's better in this more accurate picture. Then what's her story? Why did she get a cartoon? Why is she fascinating? Why did she get a cartoon and sucked away it didn't? What's the story for Pocahontas? Oh, come on now. Like you've never seen a Disney movie. You're like, what's up? She falls in love with a white dude. Thank you for that. That was fantastic. And what happens?
Her family never.
Her family's not down with it. Why? No, because he's poor. She's too good for him. The true story of Pocahontas is she's a princess and he's just some drunk pirate. The true story of Pocahontas, when we don't think about it seriously, because race didn't exist then, is the argument that I'm going to make for you guys today, right now. Race, as we think about it now, did not exist back then, because back then class was much more important, as was religion. The distinctions between people and populations in the early years of the United States, think of calling the United States, those variables were much more significant as power dynamics than were race, because race didn't exist the way we think about it now. And it's not that people didn't have pigments. It's not that they didn't have heritable traits or anything like that. It's that they didn't matter the way they do now. There's a huge difference between meeting someone who happens to be Polish and say, hey, I've got an opinion about this Polish dude, and looking up Polish people in a dictionary to see what they are.
I have a question, though. Do you think, though, that happens to differ by our class? I took a graduate class, and when I had a professor, she actually said when you get into the high class, they actually look at and they'll decide who they talk to based on who they have connections to, and that it actually is still like that today, but we don't see that because we are the majority, and that the high class actually still does that yet.
Right. We can talk about, and perhaps next time we can talk about this too, you guys now.
Yeah, so with class, race, and gender, those are the big three that I talk about frequently because they intersect in ways that are really meaningful a lot. And if you think about folks who are in the high class of every racial ethnic background in the United States, they have a different perspective on race, class, and gender.
They do.
And particularly, I'll speak from a community of which I belong, richer black folks, they really don't like hanging out with poor black folks, which means middle class folks like me and below. However, within that strata of class, of higher class, there are still distinctions. It starts to become who is a multimillionaire versus who is a billionaire. And then you can throw some race on that, and you can sort of throw some gender on that too. Because we always hear about the great big story, the internet website, a clickbait of find out who the richest woman is and figure it, all that stuff.
That's exactly it, right? And we see how these things, but the point that I would make, that I would argue, is that changes over time in different ways. For example, one of the first speeches given by a woman in front of a mixed audience in the United States was by a woman named Maria Stewart, a black woman abolitionist in 1832. And her argument in this speech against race, oh, this got really academic really quickly, it's your fault, not mine. her argument against race was that she didn't like poor black people very much, just like other white middle-class women. And that's a very historic way that she made an argument against race. But that's after race has actually kind of formed. So I want to back up just a little bit more and talk about how this idea of race happens. How we go from just interacting with people and making judgments about them to writing books about them. This guy is a big moment in the history of exactly what we're talking about. You guys know who he is, right? Napoleon. What he did when he invaded Egypt? He invaded Egypt in about 1801, and he brought with him an army of dorks. An army for real, but he carried with him an army of dorks. He got a bunch of scholars because he wasn't just going to conquer Egypt. He was going to write a book about Egyptians with a capital E. He wanted to know the essence of what an Egyptian was as he conquered them in order to conquer them. So part of the process of his invasion was writing a 17-volume book about the essence of Egypt. Do you see how that's totally different than if you go to Egypt, you meet an Egyptian guy, and you're like, hey, what's up? I guess Egyptians are like this. That's really different. And this is what we're talking about. Because that sort of travelogue gets weirder in science in the 18th and 19th century. This guy right here, Johann Friedrich Blumenbach. Interesting dude. He's doing his thing, but about 1760 to 1840 was his lifespan. Super fascinating guy, and really complex. He thought he was kind of a progressive who was interested in all kinds of different people because he made this crazy argument that perhaps people had different skin colors because of the climates in which they live. And for him, that was a kind of democratic argument because it didn't mean anything necessarily about him, about their sort of essence. But dude also, before it was creepy, had a huge collection of human skulls that he measured. In order to decide what doesn't change. Populations change when they move. Populations change because of climate. But he's saying there's something that never changes in a population. And he's going to call that race. He's also the guy who comes up with the word Caucasian. What do you guys think the word Caucasian means? Does anyone know the history of the word Caucasian? It's fascinating.
I kind of remember a bit from a professor at St. Ben's, but she taught us that it is a wildly inaccurate word not to use. And she said that the word Caucasian came from people that came from the Kaukau Mountains or something like that, and that in reality we are not Caucasian is what I remember from her. And if that is wildly inaccurate, then that's okay.
It's not. I mean, it's one of the things we're going to be working about is whether it's accurate or not. What's more important is where it comes from and what it means about us. You guys know where the Caucasus region is? It's an area of mountains. It's near Chechnya. Near Chechnya, Georgia is an area that it's an area of mountains. These kinds of things. In the past, when you talked about populations, you categorized them by language, by cultural attributes, by skin, by those kinds of things. Caucasian is the first time someone invented a word to talk about a population where it was aesthetic. It was about not that you looked a particular way, but that you looked good. And this is true, this is for real. During the 18th century, the 19th century, the best looking prostitutes were from this area of Europe. So when they came to Germany, France, those different kinds of places, people thought, wow, people there are beautiful. People there are really, really pretty. And at that point, Blumenbach goes, so are Caucasians, so are white people. We are now Caucasians from now on. And its first reference, the word Caucasian is not just skin color, it's value to the skin color. It's people who are pretty, not people who are a kind of people, but people who are a pretty kind of people. Isn't that bizarre? The other thing that's fascinating is that when we talk about Georgia, Blumenbach almost called us all Georgians, but there already was a Georgia in the United States, and it was full of convicts. So we changed his mind. So that was in a book, and there's three different versions of the book, the latest edition, 1795, which you don't care about, but it's just weird that this was invented in a particular moment, isn't it? And we live with that word, and we don't think about its heritage? And it doesn't necessarily mean the exact same thing now. This guy is a piece of work. Nathaniel Saylor. And we can talk about these different individuals forever because they're really neat. But check this out. He was one of the founders of sociology, and he did this. He did this in the first, one of the first issues of the Journal of American Sociology, which he founded in 1896. He did a study where he got a Native American dude, a dude of African descent, and a white dude. Put them all in the same room. And he did these reflex tests. I'm making this up because I don't remember it very well. He did these reflex tests where he's like, oh, I get them all through the room. And he tests their reflexes to see about their internal capacities. What is it they are on the inside based on their ability to do reflexes? And the results are a trip because this is the part that I'm making up that I don't remember perfectly, but it doesn't really matter. The European was right in the middle. The Indian was too fast. The black dude was too slow. How does he interpret that data? Why is the black population too slow? didn't say it.
They're not smart.
They're lazy.
Oh, lazy.
Right? They're too slow because they're lazy. Why is the Indian so fast? He's not thinking. It's the Goldilocks argument of social science. Now, events like this occur throughout history. Neither of these dudes woke up in the morning and said, hey, it's a great day to be a racist. What am I going to do? None of them did. They were just doing science. But the results of what they said codified what race could mean. And some of this stuff, I think, shapes how we think about race today. I'd like you now, take this seriously, because this is intense. This can be difficult. Take it at the level of intensity that you choose. But I'd like you to take a moment to think about a moment before you had a race. We talked about that before. In elementary school, it doesn't seem to matter in first, second grade. When is the moment when you realized you had a race? Does that make sense? Y'all take a moment to think about that.